I've come along here to the Cambridge Theatre to speak to the actor Jon Pertwee. As you can see from the picture behind me, here he's playing that debonair scarecrow, Worzel Gummidge, and we'll actually be talking to him between performances. Well, Jon Pertwee, you're looking very splendid in your Worzel Gummidge garb.
Yeah, he is, isn't he? Yes. Always look splendid in this.
Could we go back a few years and ask you when your career as an actor first began?
Oh, about 150 years ago. No, it's a long, long time. I come from a very old theatrical family. My father was a writer and an actor, and my grandfather and my mother's side were actors and actresses. Mm. So I never thought of doing anything else, and so I was acting from a very young age.
Did you have any formal training?
Yes, I went to the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art, where I was suitably dressed and educated, but were told that I had no future in the theatre of any sort at all.
Yes.
That I ought to leave.
Well, you spent quite a bit of time in the Navy during the war, and you, in fact, eventually became a Lieutenant Commander. And after that, you did the Navy Lark radio show. Did the two follow at all?
No, by no means. No, I was in the Navy during the war for 6 years, and the latter job that I had was in charge of naval broadcasting, and I got myself very involved with people in light entertainment. And so I turned to light entertainment myself and went into vaudeville, and I became a variety act on the music halls. And I ran that for a long time. At the same time, I was working in a radio show with Eric Barker called Waterlogged Spa as a character man. I also worked with Julian Warris in another radio show. And those ran for about 5 or 6 years each. And then I did a show of my own called Puffney Post Office, which ran for a number of years. And so I was very busily occupied with radio for many, many years before the Navy Lark ever hit the air.
Yes, you were always very good at voices. Did that make you think that radio was your natural medium?
Very much so, yes. I was very lucky to get the break which got me into it. Everybody in show business gets one or two breaks in his life, and I mercifully got one of mine very early on.
So how did you break into films then?
Well, because in those days the stars of radio were the stars of vaudeville, and the names that meant something, the light entertainment names, were the people from the vaudeville and from the radio, because there was no television.
Yes.
So I just broke through into pictures because mine was a good name to put on the marquees.
And you have had by then, of course, established yourself in the comedy role.
That's right, yes. And so I used to make an enormous number of British movies in those days. Not international movies, but British movies.
Yes, mostly bit parts in carry-on films? Or
No. That was quite wrong. The only reason I did the carry-ons is because I knew the producer and he asked me to go in for a gag. I only did two, just a little tiny, what we call cameos. Just for a giggle, just to go in and do something to do. No, I was playing feature roles and leading roles in movies for some 10, 12 years.
Mm.
Things like Mr. Drake's Duck, Miss Pilgrim's Progress, and films of that ilk. David Jacobs and I were great mates. He and I did a dreadful television series together called The Amazing Adventures of Commander High Price, who was another character that I'd been using on the radio for a number of years. And we worked that from the Alexandra Palace on little tiny television screens, about that big sort of 7-inch screens people had at home. So I was in on it from its infancy, yes.
How did you come to be offered the part which you're obviously most well known for? That's Doctor Who.
I didn't. I offered myself for it because Tenniel Evans, who was in the Navy Lark with me, said, why did you put yourself up for Doctor Who? And I said, well, why on earth would they want me? I'm a character comedy actor. And he said, oh, I don't know, I have a feeling that they might like you for it. So I suggested it to my agent, and there was a terrible pause on the other end of the telephone. And I said, well, you don't think it's a very good idea? He said, not very. He said, well, I'll try. And he rang up the producers of Doctor Who at the time, Derek Sherwin, and he said, I've got a suggestion for the new Doctor Who. So he said, how do you know there's going to be one? And he said, well, rumour is out that Pat Trout was thinking of leaving. And he said, well, actually, it is true. Yes, why? What's your suggestion? And he said, Jon Pertwee. And he said, well, that's very interesting. May I read you my shortlist? And so my agents, realising that they didn't think it was a very good idea either, said, well, why bother? I mean, let's forget the whole thing. I agree with you. They said, no, let me read you the shortlist. And they read the shortlist, which they had compiled 2 years previously, and my name was second on the list. So without knowing anything about it at all, I'd been on the list of people to play Doctor Who for over 2 years.
Having come from a comedy background, you then went on to play a very straight Doctor Who. Was that deliberate?
You must remember that I'm a great wriggler in show business. I've never really been any one specific thing. I'm turning all the time. So because you are the age you are, you don't remember that era of pictures that I was in, but they weren't all comedy roles as you would imagine them.
Yes, I'm of the generation that remembers hiding behind the sofa as you came on as Doctor,
Doctor Who.
I can just about remember you taking over from Patrick Troughton. What was it like to step into, as it were, someone else's shoes? Did you feel you were doing that, or were you
starting afresh? Not at all, because I'd never seen it.
Yes, so you didn't really have any preset ideas?
No, none at all, because I'd never watched it. I'd never seen Doctor Who. I was too busy working myself. I never had a chance to see it. I think I did see it once, because my ex-wife was in it, Jean Marsh. And she was in one series, and I think she may have persuaded me to have a look at her in that, and I think I saw a few series that she was in.
So you very much seem to make the part your own. Did you have any collaboration with any of the writers?
No, none. You never do, because the show is written, long before you have a chance to work on it, because I'm busy working on one story, and then as soon as I've recorded that, we have one day off, and then you're back in the studio the next day, and you're rehearsing straight away at the new stories. You don't get a chance to talk to the writers. What they did do, the writers, they found out that I was a lover of gadgetry, that I rode my own motorbikes and I flew aeroplanes and could drive speedboats and water ski and drive hovercraft and all these things. So all this sort of love of gadgetry came into Doctor Who, and they gave it free rein. And if I went to the boat show and I saw some incredible piece of machinery, I'd say, that's good. And Barry Letts would say, right, well, we'll write it into the program, which was what we used to do. So we made it a sort of science fiction James Bond, and I was involved in Aikido, of course, too, which was when martial arts were becoming popular. And also, of course, the fact that I wore rather fancy gear.
Yes, it is said that you're a very flamboyant dresser.
That's right. Well, that's because Pat had been the opposite, so I wanted to do completely opposite to what Pat had been, you see. And Katie Manning, my then leading lady, she was very into clothes and gear as well, and of course she wore marvellous 60s and miniskirts and hot pants and boots and all this gear, which of course appealed to the girls and the boys. So again, we had another little facet to our bow with and I was the first Doctor Who in colour, remember.
Your appearances as Doctor Who always seem to be very polished and professional. You obviously had a very serious attitude to the part, is that true?
Yes, very much so, mainly because I'd been a vaudevillian for a long time and I wanted to establish myself once again as a straight actor. I mean, long before I'd gone into vaudeville, I'd been a straight actor. I mean, I was in the West End in a straight theatre and been touring, I'd been in rep and so on and as a straight actor, Shakespearean roles and everything else. And so this was an opportunity for me to do.
What about the actual playing of Doctor Who? Did you ever feel that you were just a cog in the wheel of a lot of fancy special effects and gadgetry?
Very much so.
Yes.
I used to have great problems with a lot of the dialogue because it was scientific claptrap that I understood not a jot of. And I was pretty sure that the majority of the audience didn't understand it either. So in my era, we took a lot of that out. I didn't approve of that. It was talking too much science. The writers, you know, they become rather self-indulgent and they get themselves really buried into some great theory, some scientific theory, when they'll go on and so get very, very deeply into it. And I said, no, this is too much. I used to like it, keep it adventuresome and exciting and with lots of things for them to look at, lots of action, lots of movement.
Were there any particularly memorable episodes of Doctor Who that stick out?
Yes, The Demons, my favourite I ever made.
What happened there?
But The Demons was made without monsters. It was just an atmosphere. Did you not see it, The Demons?
I can't remember it.
Well, The Demons was one we shot entirely on film in a little village outside Marlborough. He's nodding his head, he saw it. And they opened barrows up. You know what barrows are, these tombs.
Yes, I remember seeing
and
that.
And there were tremendous winds, and it came out. And actually, the master, my great friend Roger Delgado, he summoned up the devil in this little village church and through black magic. And there were these tremendous winds that blew everything over. And it was much more spooky than monsters, I thought. And I had a great belief. When I was Doctor Who, I made a statement once, which has been much quoted since, saying there's nothing more alarming than coming home and finding a Yeti sitting on your loo in Tooting Beck. If you see just that in Tooting Beck, you are horrified and frightened and you run for the exits. If, on the other hand, you're in the Himalayas and you see a yeti on your loo, and you don't find that that's at all surprising because you expect him to be there.
Mm.
Well, by the same token, I like to bring all the threats to Earth. So I was very keen on keeping unit. I liked working with Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart and Sergeant Benton and all that group, and the Havoc, that very good stunt team with my stuntman Terry Walsh. That was a good era, I thought, and I think very, very exciting. And a large percentage of my fans of Doctor Who liked that particular attitude, finding, you know, Daleks going over Waterloo Bridge, or finding prehistoric monsters in the Underground Railway, finding nasty sort of jelly substances creeping along walls. There's something much more spooky in that than if you go to a planet where you expect to see these things happening.
You've mentioned the Daleks on Waterloo Bridge.
Yes.
I've heard that you didn't, in fact, like playing with the Daleks.
No, I didn't. I hated them. I thought they were idiotic things. So they looked so stupid. I mean, they looked as if they were made of cardboard and sink pumps. Well, they were. There was a sink pump sticking on the end. I think they were very well operated, and I had tremendous admiration for the people that worked them, like John Scott Martin and Peter Bix and people like that, who for years worked these monsters. Mm. And it was a tremendous job, tough job to do. I mean, they had to walk around on their tippy toes and maneuver these things that have about 18 hands to flash lights. They, you know, they even used to learn their dialogue, all the dialogue of the Daleks, which was read by an actor with a throat mic on, a distorting mic. And yet those workers, like John Scott Martin, would actually learn every line of dialogue spoken so that he could flash his light in time and move the turrets. Marvellous workers.
But why do you think they are so incredibly popular?
Because they were marvellous for people to impersonate. It was wonderful for a child to go, exterminate, exterminate, and that's it.
Yes.
You just you run along on tippy toes and you hold your hand out. It was a thing. I mean, we tried it, after all, with dozens of other things, because I wanted to see if I could make money out of these things. I'm very commercially minded. And we invented all kinds of other things, with new monsters and weird things. And I kept going on with the people of the invention so that I could copyright them, because I'd invented them, got them to draw. We never, ever could get anything to beat the Dalek. That was the one that's been the big seller. That's the only one, the only thing that's really been a big seller in Doctor Who. Apart from, you know, some certain sidelines like T-shirts and chocolate bars and things like that.
Why did you leave the part then?
Well, 5 years is a long time. Remember, I hadn't originated it.
Mm.
I mean, I'd play Worzel Gummidge for 20 years because it's I originated it. It's me. Nobody else can do it, I don't think.
Mm.
I may be wrong. Somebody else having said that. But, but anybody can play Doctor Who because we're all different people. I mean, you can have your own conceptions of how it should be played. I mean, Peter Davidson's obviously going to be utterly different to me, and I was utterly different to Pat, and Pat was utterly different to Bill Hartnell, and so on, and Tom. We've all got our own ideas of how to play these things.
Yes.
I personally don't like messing about when dealing with threats. I think you should go straight down the middle. I think if you've got a monster to deal with, you go and deal with it. You don't skit around the edges.
Mm.
You don't fall over a scarf, or you don't play a penny whistle. But that's just my attitude towards it.
Because we can't forget that you're playing Worzel Gummidge at the moment.
Well, look, quite so. It's a bit difficult talking about Doctor Who with all this gear on.
Yes, yeah, shall we go on then to Worzel Gummidge? Did you invent the part? How did it come about?
No, Barbara Ufen Todd, the author, wrote the books in the 30s, and it became the first Puffin book, which was the first paperback book for children. It was immensely popular, still is, not because of us, but I mean, throughout the years it's been immensely popular as a children's book. About 8 years ago, Keith Waterhouse and Willis Hall sent for me and asked me to go to a meeting with Gareth Wigan, the film producer, to see whether I'd be interested in playing Worzel in a movie of that name. And I realised that they remembered this character, the postman, that I had played on the radio all those years ago. We used to have the same sort of voice, say, what does it matter what you do as long as you tear him up? And this was a great catchphrase that everybody knew, and I'd always wanted to find a character that would suit that voice. And I'd played it in a few movies and it had worked very well. And I had a radio series called Puffney Post Office and it had worked very well on that. And I said, I know this is going to work on television, but what am I going to do it with? And then suddenly I was offered this film. And unfortunately the film didn't happen, and we couldn't get the distribution, we couldn't get the money, and so it was abandoned. But I persuaded Keith Waterhouse and Willis Hall to write me a pilot for television. I offered it to Thames, that I was under contract with then. I was making a series called Who Done It. And then they turned it down, and they said they didn't think it had any future at all. I then offered it to the BBC, and I thought, well, they'll grab it, because I was nicely out of Doctor Who by this time. They didn't think it had any future either. They turned it down. By this time, I began to lose a bit of confidence in it. But no, eventually I was able to persuade the people at the Southern that it was going to work, and it did work. And within 4 or 5 weeks, we were somewhat of a cult. And we have been until now, and now we're faced with this ridiculous situation that here we've got a show watched by millions, we're doing it on the stage, it's packing the theatre out wherever we go. It's nothing for us to get 30,000, 40,000 people can turn up to see us, Una and I doing personal appearances at weekends, and yet that's the end of it.
So you're pretty bitter about that?
No, you can't be bitter in show business. No, not bitter at all. I'm just surprised. I can't believe, really, that any company that's in television for the business of being in television can seriously say we can afford not to take over a program with the popularity of this. It just doesn't make any sense to me. I'm just baffled by it. I mean, at the moment we're negotiating with the Americans. If they, of course, take us, which we hope they will, and it looks very rosy. If they do take us, they'll strip show them, which means they show them every day for 5 days a week. And that means that very quickly they will have got rid of the 34 programs we've made.
Yeah.
And we hope then they'll say, we want some more of this, if it's as popular as I think it might be. And if they want more, well, then we'll... Then what happens? Then they say, the Americans say, well, do you want to go ahead and make them, or do we make them in America? We'd prefer to make them here, obviously, because it's not an American subject, really.
Yeah.
Although they have scarecrows, and I don't see any reason why we shouldn't integrate. We could integrate American scarecrows, black scarecrows, and it would be very good. There's marvellous black character actors in America.
How long does it take to put your Worzel Gummidge makeup on?
About an hour. I'm usually in the theatre 2 hours before the curtain goes up. An hour just to do correspondence and mail, and then I, 1 hour before I start to put it on. It's quite an involved process. I have to stick a rubber nose on, first of all, and then get the yellow base, and then put the corner eyebrows and the things. It takes quite a long time.
Isn't it, with all that straw on you, aren't you perpetually itchy?
No, it's not real straw. It's ersatz, and it doesn't... I don't even feel it. It's all sewn into the costume anyway. It's much easier way of doing it.
Well, Jon Pertwee, thanks for sparing the time to let us come along to talk to you, and the best of luck for the future, be it Worzel Gummidge or whatever else.
Oh, Doctor Who, you never know. I might go back to Doctor Who.
Yeah. Thank you.
Right.